when you look at what's eventually going to happen there with them leaving, do you think even more so to watch the competition in that conference because of what some of those other teams are facing? The future of that conference seems like it's getting dark.
Well, the future of that conference, I mean, it was already a behemoth, and now you add Texas and especially Oklahoma. You know, Texas is more about the brand. You know, it's like adding the Cowboys to a conference. I mean, it's a huge brand. Much like the Cowboys, they haven't done anything lately. Mm-hmm. I think that's what people are excited to see what they can do. And they want to see Texas with Sark be the team that they should be. I mean, we're talking about Michigan. Texas is kind of a mirror image. You know, they have ridiculous facilities, ridiculous high school football in that state. You would think that year in and year out, they have what it takes to be a top five, top 10 team at the very least. And they've not been able to do that. We'll see if Sark can get them going. But joining the SEC along with Oklahoma, that SEC is going to be an interesting conference. I mean, it's created uncertainty. You heard the alliance quote that you guys played when we came back. You know, what is this alliance with the ACC, the Big Ten, and the Pac-12? You know, what is happening with their three conference commissioners? You have Greg Sankey as the SEC commissioner. At some point, no matter what the alliance's agenda is, what the SEC agenda is, at some point, for the betterment of the players and the sport and the coaches, they've all got to come together and get in the same room. Right now, it seems like everybody's alienated, everybody's apart. And if they're ever going to fix college football, they've all got to figure out a way to come back together.
Yeah, you want to see everybody come together. And that's, I think, I'm trying to figure out what the alliance is, like you were just talking about.
Is it a way to answer the SEC,
or is it something about scheduling? I can't figure it out.
Well, to me, what the alliance is right away, the first thing that came to mind was the SEC, no matter how big and how strong and powerful they are, which they are, they only have, when you get into those meetings, they have one vote. You know, you have one vote to three. So if you're voting on expansion or you're voting on any kind of legislation of anything you're trying to do as a group, these three are basically saying, kind of like the show Survivor, they're building an alliance, and like however we're whatever they're going to put on the table, the three of us are in cahoots, the three of us are in alignment. We see the world collectively the same. They see the world differently, but you know what, we've got three votes, so they only have one. That's the only thing that I can think of. I don't know where it's going to go, but I think initially I think those three conferences were scared, were hurt, feelings were hurt, and I think they reacted in a way of kind of saving face from a PR standpoint, and so they created this alliance and made to try to make their fans and their constituents feel like, okay, you know, these 41 institutions are all coming together, and that creates power. That's what they're trying to do. But at the end of the day, for now, it gives them three votes to the one of the SEC.
Hey, Kurt, when I'm watching what's unfolding in the Big 12, I feel like I'm watching an episode of Oregon Trail, man. I feel like dysentery, dehydration. At some point, it's going to become like the Big East, right? It's going to be, you know, disbanded, right? And, you know, right now the alliance is fun. It's all nice, right? Everybody's playing well in the sandbox. How soon before they start pillaging from the Big 12 and then all bets are off?
Well, everyone's kind of anticipating something's going to happen, right? Like everyone's thinking, well, what's the Pac-12 going to do? They came out and made an announcement that, hey, we're not going to expand. The Big 12 right now kind of feels like they were a Power 5, and now it feels like, is their future kind of like where the American is, where they're just kind of on the cusp? What are they going to do? Who are they going to bring in? I think a lot of people want to see what Bob Boolsby as the commissioner, what he and his presidents and again, their leadership group, what is their play? What is their move? You lose Texas and Oklahoma. I mean, that's two huge brands. And this is a league that already lost A&M and Nebraska and Missouri. So like if they had their original members, it would be such a different league, but to already lose what they've lost and then you take away Texas and OU, makes it very hard to envision this league still being recognized as a Power 5, which is sad to me because you're looking at some really good brands still left behind. So I don't know what the next play is. I don't know if the SEC or Big Ten or or Pac-12 are going to take up some of those teams. I have no idea. But for now, it kind of feels like the Big 12, what's left of it, is trying to stick together. Maybe they add a Houston. I don't know. Maybe they add a Cincinnati because of the West Virginia tie-in. I don't know who they might add, but it seems like they're trying to stick together as long as they can.
Barton Hahn with Kirk Herbstreit right now on the Goodyear Hotline. Clemson, Georgia are out of the gate to start the season. We don't have expanded playoffs yet. So is the loser already in trouble after week one?
Well, in college football with the committee, at the end of the year, you get into December, everybody kind of talks about the term they use is cluster. So like if you're looking at the end of the year and you got first team, second team, third team, and then you got 4, 5, 6, and 7, you got these teams that are in a cluster together. The committee tries to separate that cluster with either using head-to-head competition or are you a conference champion, whatever it might be. If you're Clemson and you were to lose to Georgia, there's a really good chance both Clemson and Georgia could end up in that top six. And the last thing you want at the end of the year is to, if you lose that head-to-head matchup, that's a game changer. And you'll lose that argument every single time. So with that in mind, I really feel that even though it's week one, you can still obviously, you know, fix a wrong. If you end up at the end of the year, you're looking across the table, and that's the team you lost to in week one, then you're going to be left out. So, yeah, with that in mind, there's a lot at stake in that game in Charlotte.
Thanks for watching ESPN on YouTube. For live streaming sports and premium content, subscribe to ESPN Plus right now.